Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Nō mai, haere mai. Colin Freeman, Jenny, welcome to all of you to this gathering, the 26th Forest and Bird Centennial Poetry and Art Inspired by Nature. It is such a special thing to gather together in one place. All of you who've been involved with this project for this one moment in this beautiful gallery. The words and the artworks created to help Forest and Bird celebrate our 100 years of hard Māori. To the writers and artists who are here, thank you so much. You have created pāonga for the society and we could not be more grateful to you. It's a very emotional experience. I've seen the works on paper, I've seen the works on screen. There's nothing like going and seeing the works in person and soon to hear the words delivered by those who wrote them with such love and such insight. It is a great pleasure. We have housekeeping or gallery keeping, health and safety. In the event of an emergency, please exit via the stairs to the main Lopdell House foyer or via the South Tikirangi Road and through the theatre auditorium. There is an exit from the bar. The assembly point, always important to know, is the treasure house behind Lopdell House. In the event of an earthquake, we know something of these coming from Wellington as I have this morning, drop and cover. After the shaking stops, obey the instructions from the event organisers and stay alert for aftershocks. Designated first aider is Kate. There is a first aid kit located on the level one kitchenette at the end of the corridor, and Kate also has a forest mover. So if you need any assistance, please do not hesitate to let us know. And please report all injuries, near misses and incidents to a member of Forest and Bird staff. Now, for me, one of the most important messages, please have your phones on silent or airport mode. You do not want to be, there's always one, right? And a lot of tisking. So phones on silent, please, would be lovely. Today's presentations are being videoed. Thank you very much. And we do plan to share them with edited online version and also for those who couldn't come in this way today so they don't miss out. It's a really important moment for us and we wanted to capture it. Each creative pair of writer and artist, sometimes solo, are going to come forward and speak to you, and at the back you'll see their work projected. It's quite something, some of those small works to see them so large. It's breathtaking. But first, I'm delighted to invite to the stage the Deputy President of Forest and Bird, Kate Graham. Kate, thank you.
Kia ora koutou. Ko Kate Takawingwa, nō taranga aho. So as Lynn said, I'm Kate Graham. I'm Deputy President of Forest and Bird, which is a real privilege to be in that role of such a wonderful valued organisation. And what a wonderful event to be at today. I am so thrilled to be here and so grateful to all the beautiful artistic contributions that people have given to celebrate 100 years of Forest and Bird and to celebrate nature. And we all give in quite different ways, I think, to conservation and to Forest and Bird. And this is just a really beautiful expression of that and a really hopeful one too. So I wanted to just start with karakia timatanga. Ko ranganui e tūnei, ko papatūinuku e takoto nei, kia kūmanutia, ko te taiao kia mau, kia tina, tina, huia, taiki. For 100 years, Forest and Bird has been associated with nature and advocating for nature. We're storytellers, we tell stories of winds, losses and hope, and there is always hope, and this is such a hopeful event. When we tell those stories in all sorts of different ways, as today or to taiao, the voice of nature. That's what we do, and that's exactly what all these amazing writers and artists are doing here today. This project is a creative collaboration between Forest and Bird and 26NZ. So for those who haven't heard of 26NZ, it's a global not-for-profit writers group. And we're very grateful that they have come together with us to share and mark our 100th birthday using the power of poetry, and art to amplify our conservation messages. So we've randomly paired up 26 New Zealand writers and artists and asked them to travel together to visit 13 of Forest and Birds conservation projects, all throughout Aotearoa, including our smallest, our largest, our remotest, and our oldest. And at all the projects, they met with our branch volunteers and our project staff and shared the challenges and joys of looking after our native wildlife. So that constant need for vigilance against those rats, possums and stoats, the backbreaking work of planting native trees and constantly removing weeds. Each creative pair responded to the people, places and spaces they encountered during their visits, and it's been just, it's amazing to actually see today in the site those different ways that they have interpreted those. So during their visits, the writers had to create a 100-word centenna that started and finished with the same three words. They also penned a 260-word essay reflecting on their visit. The artists used a variety of mediums, which we've seen upstairs, to create all these amazing original artworks. And we are so looking forward to sharing with you all of these beautiful pieces of work and the incredible contribution that has been made through our conservation volunteers protecting Te Taiao, our natural world. We are proud to have been a really strong advocate for nature for a century, but we're also very realistic that our job is not done, and it is a real challenge to keep on facing those threats and to be advocating for our flora and fauna in Aotearoa with the ongoing threat of climate change and habitat loss. But there's much we can do to protect and restore it, but we need to do that together. This project and today's event is helping us to really amplify the really urgent message that we need to look after Te Taiao. So thank you so much to all of the artists and writers, and particularly to the 26 New Zealand writer editors, Jane Workman, Jane Burney and Paul White, who have led this creative project. I'd also like to acknowledge Forest and Birds branches and all our volunteers who have generously hosted the artists and writers. We are about to be transported through these pieces of art and poetry, so I invite you to sit back and enjoy.
Hello everyone, it's an honour to be here with you all, and thank you all for coming. My name's Si Dowling, and I'm a pencil and pen illustrator, and with this artwork I have experimented a bit more with some other mediums and used a bit of paint and watercolour as well. And it is a very large artwork that I didn't know how to transport here, so the only way to get it here was to drive myself, so I've driven it from Christchurch, which resulted in nearly not getting here, stuck in the desert road, so it's been quite an adventure to get it here. It wasn't that big, but still big. Paul and I travelled to the far north of New Zealand, to Forest and Birds, northernmost reserve at near Hauhora Heads, and we met with Mariana, the lovely branch manager, who showed us around the reserve, which was once a private garden that's been transported back to its former state. And through the experiences that informed how this artwork would look, I tried to communicate the idea of the workers in Forest and Bird looking after a society of the wildlife through meeting a trapper there named Murray, and he is embodied in the Katara kingfisher, who is taking care of the pests. So that's the main theme of this artwork, with the gold border also being the sacred nature and and the freesias, which cannot be removed from the landscape outside of the gold frame. So that's the general theme of this artwork. Take it away, Paul.
Simon and I have never met before, and I'm really glad we've met now, because it's been fantastic working together. We both went a long way. I thought I was going a long way from Auckland. Simon went even further. And so I decided to call this poem This Far North, because it felt like we'd really gone that far north. And what was great about working with Simon was that when we sent each other our first bits of work, Simon sent me about 6 sketches, and as soon as I saw that image, I went, that's the one we need to do. But also what was important was that I had written some drafts of the poem, but I couldn't finish it. I couldn't work out how to finish it until I saw the picture, and then that gave me the end. And as you've just heard, it's the first 3 words and the last 3 words are always the same, so you'll see. So, entitled This Far North. Between two oceans hides a hollow place, where forest now is no more than buried wood, shrouded in a blanket made of swamp. Above, life breathes, though some of it needs killing. Rats, possums, mice, and weeds are not what any garden wants. What gardens want was grown here once. Full fragrant freesias still bloom every year beside tall raupo, adolescent kauri trees, next to umbrella ferns where rare frogs leap, bitterns boom, and small working bees tend the place with human hands. While Hunch Kotare watching know the best place to look for fish is not between two oceans.
Kia ora everyone, my name's Leah Royden, and I've had the incredible privilege of being part of 26 and part of this project, working alongside Sophia Nolce. I shall have to speak up. Working alongside Sophia Nolce, who sadly cannot be here today. And so I'd like to just begin. I'll read a little bit about, in Sophia's words, about her work, which is called Brittle Branches. The North Island kaka clings to a bare branch. Many of our bird species hang from fragile branches that could snap at any moment. Extinction looms, and without dedicated individuals, bird populations could collapse. Many compassionate people have united to protect and raise awareness for offshore islands, and they serve as safety rafts for recovering species. Our Sefai Whenua Reserve is the result of many years of dedication from the people of Waiheke. Their planting and predator control has created a habitat abundant with native fruits and flowers. This has encouraged the return of birds, and their songs now fill a space that was once farmland. So I've called my poem The Slow Work, and I like to think of my journey to Atu Whai Whenua as kind of a lesson in the human capacity to create. I think as a writer, and maybe I can only speak for myself, but I could say we tend to be, quite dark and thoughtful people sometimes. Again, speaking only for myself. And I find myself in my work often overly drawn to the sort of human capacity to destroy, you know, darkness, serious things. We've all seen the sorts of images, you know, just being a human in the world, we see these images of decimated landscapes, fires, you know, sadness, grief, wrath and ruin. And going to Atu Whai Whenua and meeting with Ivan, our guide there, was like just this glorious opposite day. I'm standing here looking at pictures of what this land used to be in this green, green, glorious native bush that was once brown deadness, overgrazed, gone, sad, full of landslips. And Yeah, it struck me something about what it is to give the work of one's life for something that will outlive you. Sort of everyday commitment to the love of caring for the land. And when I knew, I think I knew what shape my centennial was going to take when Ivan put his hands around this tree, that he said, you know, I don't know if I've planted this one specifically, but I'd just like to check on it and just see, you know, how much it's grown over my lifetime. I just thought that was incredible. So, on the way back, I started writing the slow work. Make a stand of puriri, a copse of kahikatea, a shambles of manuka. Dig deep, make a hole, make 100, make a day of it, a lifetime. Count the years measured between stretched fingertips as you hug the kauri close. Trace the scars of yesterday through sun-scattered undergrowth. Catch a glimpse of tomorrow tucked warm under a kaka's wing. Check your watch. Healing is the slow work, seeds flung across time into tomorrow's unknown. This place, this moment, born screaming small across bare earth, bitten raw. Draw back your arm, plant your feet, and make a stand. Thank you.
Tēnā koe. Ko le Ryan Tokoinua. Tēnā koe kia te kaurarau. Māki, who of course whose land we are gathered on. And tēnā koe to Kathy, who is the artist who made this stunning piece of art. She has COVID, unfortunately. So I know she's streaming in, so kia ora, Kathy. And I'm going to read what she wrote. Seeing Ark in the park for the first time is awe-inspiring. From the Puke Matikeo lookout, it's everything the light touches. It's a 2,270 hectare reserve with no boundary fence. It's incredible that the army of volunteers consistently trap or bait every 50 metres of it to allow the native wildlife to recover and thrive. The artwork shows the Ark from the highest point, looking out to the west coast and Tehenga, Bethel's Beach, with Tui and Kereru flying overhead. The returned kōkako and native wildlife emerge from the forest, resting on the bare branches of the ancient kauri tree, Agatha, who has succumbed to kauri dieback disease. Below, the regenerating forest comes alive amongst the lush leaves of the undergrowth. This amazing project is a collaboration between Forest and Bird, Auckland Council, and supported by local mana whenua, Te Kaurarau o Māki, Āmāki. So some of you will know, 20 years ago, this sanctuary, people envisioned, persuaded, fundraised to make this come into being. And there are 300 volunteers who take care of the pests. And I'm just going to read you a section. Kathy and I came out over two weekends. My family come, we were in Kumiu, and my mum died during those two visits. So it seems really important. And it does capture a bit of that darkness that we as writers are all prone to. I turned left into Falls Road, the scars drawn by the cyclone, which happened last summer, and the storms are visible on the landscape, slips, landslides, fallen trees. The rahui remains. Aunt Agatha, ancient kauri and tupuna, has succumbed to the kauri dieback disease. Her ash-white limbs linger, stark against the dark green bush, marking her demise after centuries of standing watch. And on this Saturday morning, a steady stream of people arrive. They have a quiet intensity, preparing by carefully packing bait,
hammers, saws, into a small backpack, and the focus they need for tackling the ever-changing, potentially wet and slippery terrain of their bait line. And I thought on the trip home about how that this group is really a model for what we're going to be doing in the future, like those small and ongoing acts of restoration. And I also thought of Bertolt Brecht's quote about, in the dark times will there be singing? Yes, there will also be singing about the dark times. So the centenna is called a living ark. Forging a sanctuary with their long limbs, the molten veins of Totara and Kauri draw in nature's fire from earth to sky, catching light and water for a grasping city. Their leaves flicker green. Yet this forest of Tiriwa endures a human strain. Our Kauri queen, witness to 40 generations, now skeletal, ash white, still. While in the darkness, ravenous stoats and rats devour fledgling heartbeats. See now volunteers hike with bait, a steady glow meeting ancestors in trunk and leaf. Smell wet ferns, moss, fresh earth. Listen, tui, keriru, kokekel, like their forest kin. They are forging a sanctuary.
Thank you. It's emotional. Today, it's been a long time coming. And I've been involved with the Auckland South Branch for a number of years, more or less. I was excited to be allocated the Ngāhere Tōpū Reserve because it's close to my home in Manurewa, and for as long as I can remember, I've cherished this forest, even though up to last year I'd only ever driven by it. Murray, the chairman of our branch and dedicated caretaker of this reserve, along with Graham and Kevin and many others, they have been for many years vital to the condition this forest is currently in. It was Murray who gave us a guided tour of the bush nearly a year ago now, mostly from the road, because so much of it is so dense and sloping that it's rather impenetrable. To get into the forest, you have to almost go on all fours and slide down on your backside. Quite gnarly. When I began the artwork for this project, I was thinking I might do a forest scene focusing on the stream and the interior and kāhepea, as that was one of the apparent features of this forest. But once we'd visited, we decided that it was not quite right. Then we considered a stand of kauri in the northern boundary, but I couldn't get a satisfying image of that. So then, after turning to various maps, like Auckland Council's GIS ones and things, I discovered that the pūriri, which there are two of these, side by side. The pūriri along the road represented many of the themes we wanted to cover and has a good dynamism, and that the branches arch over the road and the road is diminishing into the distance around a corner. So one of the things, probably obviously, was that of waste. Initially we weren't going to include it, but during our tour, we decided that that was quite a strong element of this reserve. It's part of this place's story and will remain so if we don't change our approach and perceptions to waste and the environment. The theme of rejection, in fact, is quite layered. This land was too difficult to farm, and it was too impenetrable to deforest. And across the road, there's a clean field site. So this whole region is all about sort of rejection, which
which I thought was quite interesting. And Stoat references a similar matter in that the land and why will always be at risk of a re-invasion, and that it is only through our surveillance and action that this invasion and re-invasion are managed. Despite the boundaries we give to reserves, by way of roads, etc., their borders are porous to invaders and welcome residents alike. While we found it difficult terrain to traverse, they have no trouble getting in and leaving. So with the kaka, this is referencing kind of thing well beyond this reserve, but all the same tied into conservation and volunteering. It represents the fact that some years ago, Forest and Bird established the Southeast Wild Link, and this particular reserve is one of the portions of this eco corridor. And so this reserve is not just vital to its patch, but well beyond it. It's, you know, one of many in a link, in a chain that enables our species to get all the way up to Northland, out to the Gulf Islands and south. So this is also, as well, the idea of solastalgia came into this, where we collectively, probably, at least I do, mourn the loss of what we've had in terms of deforestation and the conversion of our land to so many other uses. The fact that our environment has transformed so much, this remnant is all we have left. So to round off, this reserve represents hope for our future, and if we're all attentive and consistent about how it is, that's all, if we're all consistent and attentive to how we care for it. Sorry, Paul, your turn.
No, it's all right.
Paul's standing in for my writing partner, Chris.
Yes, I was going to say it wasn't me that slid down on my arse. So, which is why my trousers are so clean, however. I'm going to do my world famous impersonation of Chris Bowring, who's a very good friend and a tremendous writer. I met up with Amy and Chris at a cafe after they visited. And I don't think that Amy had actually really heard what Chris wanted to say. But he read it out to us and we just were in silence. Excuse me. Because he really found it transforming just to go there, and he really felt that he was leaving behind that sort of world that we all get trapped in with the rubbish, and he really did find something else there, and I think he's captured it beautifully in this centina, which is entitled Let Go. In this moment, I am here. Tires tossed down the bank, totems of irresponsibility distract. I look away, let go. I fix my gaze on the descent of nourishing skies. Rain feeds Nikau, Puriri, Kahikatea during a gentle ride to the ground. It softens the soil and my heart. The buzz of a phone. Did I send that email? I switch it off, I let go. The conversation of birds is joyous. My soul soars. A retreat from unnecessary noise. Am I enough? Let go. A breath in, a breath out. All I am is in this moment.
Seems a bit across the stage.
<Thank you. laughs> Hello, I'm Lindsay Dawson, and I'm standing in here also for my artist Danika Tukua, who lives in Pihikihi and unfortunately is unable to be here. We both went to the Walter Scott Reserve on Mount Korongia in the Waikato, and she wrote, "This place is very dear to my heart. My family have lived and farmed in this area for many generations. When visiting, as we both did, We were followed by a fantail and greeted by a kereru, and they are the stars of her painting, you know, alongside the reserve's stunning flora. That greenstone taonga that you can see around the kereru's neck represents a large patu found by her own grandfather when clearing scrub at Nutanui. With moa and hui of fossil remains found on this mountain, one can't help, says Janika, feeling a spiritual connection and immense curiosity about who and what walked before us. And it was a privilege for both of us to go to this beautiful piece of bush, especially for me, because years ago I met a lovely Maori man called Malcolm Forbes, and we joked because I had a Forbes in my ancestry as well, and we thought perhaps we were cousins from Scotland. And he said he was the principal of the Whare Wananga in Te Awamutu at the time, and he said that whenever he felt stressed, he would climb Mount Marongia to speak Parongia, sorry, to speak to the Patu Paerehi, the fairy people. And I went, oh, really? I'd never met anybody who'd spoken to a fairy person before. And I said, what did they look like? And he said, well, you know, quite small, maybe about this high, and pale. But they were immensely personal and precious to him, and he always felt less stressed after he'd been up the mountain to speak with them. And to become less stressed, you know, all of us know that the best thing to do is to go into a piece of beautiful New Zealand bush, and the Walter Scott Reserve certainly is. I thought, when I heard about it first, I thought, what, so Walter Scott? But no. This particular reserve was gifted to Forest and Bird back in 1963, 100 acres of kind of virgin bush, which sat alongside the farm owned by two very strong women, Molly and Lillian Valder. They loved the bush, and they decided they wanted to be kept virginal. And Molly was apparently a very cultured lady who played a grand piano in their funny little old farmhouse on their farm. And Lillian was really handy with an axe and a shotgun. She would tell friends about how she used to shoot possums out her kitchen window. So, wonderful women these were. When I was in the Waikato, I happened to hear a piece on Radio New Zealand about changes going on in farming. I heard about the fact that some farmers are now using drones instead of sheepdogs, and that on dairy farms, some cows have special collars which are GPS tracked, and so little signals through their collars can tell them when it's milking time and where to go, which just amazed me. And I thought, what a difference the world, how different the world is now compared with the 1930s and 40s when Molly and Lillian were struggling to farm with their friend, Walter Scott, next door, their lovely mentor, after whom they called the reserve. And so, because of all of that change, I've written a little piece, a centina, called Going Without. So much change. That noise is a drone herding sheep without dogs. Those collars corral cows obeying GPS signals without fences. But this bushy slope on the mountain's shoulder thrives without technology. These 100 acres hum with silence, glow with green, smell of loam and leaf fall, and showcase tender baby ferns that draw circles in the air. No whizzy gadgets here. But only one piwaka waka speaks up. One kereru lumbers by. One distant tui calls. Shouldn't there be more? Just as well, kind people mindfully tend this place, for without their care, there will be, oh, so much change. And my thanks go to Philip Hart and Bruce Dean, who were the very kind Forest and Bird volunteers who took us around the Walter Scott Reserve.
Good afternoon, I'm Sophie Mankowski. I did a pottery piece, and mine is not 2D, it is 3D. And it is called Join the Flock. I created this as a response to the amazing day out to the Forest and Bird Lower Heart Bush Reserve, together with two volunteers and my writer mate, Scott Moores, who couldn't be here today.
Lohat Bush is a very special place, one where precious birds make their homes, free of danger of predators. Here they nest and fly and find their food. Such special breeds we never see in our gardens. They are really vulnerable to loss of habitat and predation. The piece of land was gifted years ago, an insight for a farmer who saw its potential as a nature reserve, and it is full of craggy limestone formations and very old trees, some hollow. Walking up to the viewpoint, we could see out to the lands beyond, some bush and some forestry further afield. No protection here for wildlife, so our forest and bird reserve is unique in this landscape. We hope to educate young and old so they can see the beauty of our native flora and fauna. My hollow tree contains whitehead, popocatia, I can't say the Maori words too well, New Zealand robin, totowai, miru miru, tomtits, tutupona murai from him, and kui, shining cuckoo. So I made the ones that are very special and that you never see in our gardens. Since arriving from my home country of Germany many decades ago, I have become bit by bit a true admirer of our native birds, native lizards and native trees. I can say that they have grown on me, and I feel passionately about their existence and their survival into the future. Yes, some of the birds are on the brink, but it is never too late to care, as the world would be so much the poorer without them. Every day it dawns on me more how in days gone by, birds and trees were abundant in our environment and now they are not. With this sculpture, I'm trying to educate those who do not know how important it is to look after these birds. In my hometown of Havelock North, many people grow trees with the idea of connecting habitat. Reserves and private gardens could merge to allow more bird life, and it is happening already. I have grey warbler and fantails nesting in my trees at home. My pottery is inspired by the wealth of birds in New Zealand. In the past, I have created life-size albatross, whiu, kereru, kakapo, takahi, potare, tieke, chui, piwakawaka, kakariki, and kia, and kokaku. Also, my cups have sculpted lizards for handles, which were inspired many decades ago by seeing many types of geckos and skinks in the care of a lizard enthusiast who had a license by the Department of Conservation. So because Scott Moyes is not here, I've been practicing his poem, and I feel very privileged to read it out to you. In Robin's Hood by Scott Moyes. In Robin's Hood, we do not take, though riches do surround us. Instead, we steal a moment with the treasures that have found us. We bow our humble heads to the Matai on the throne, to the 800-year dynasty, the kingdom that they have grown. The limestone is the wordsmith, the history engraver, the mushroom the artist, the colour that we savour. Yes, there are the scoundrels, the clever midnight thieves. We also have our servants soaring high amongst the trees. Our kereru, our tui, our bellbirds of the woods, and those who perch beside us, insisting we are in Robin's Hood.
Mm-hmm. Aotearoa, everyone. Thank you so much for being here and allowing us to share our work and hopefully send the ripples of these messages out into the world to a wider audience. My name is Joan Workman. I'm a writer living in Whanganui, and I was lucky enough to be paired with Anya, who created this beautiful artwork. We were gifted by Forest and Bird the opportunity to write about the Rangitiki reserves. For those of you who don't know, it's a handful, five pockets of pristine forest bordered by the Awa, Rangitiki, Turakina and Mangahoe. Anya and I, the reserves were gifted to Forest and Bird. It's a similar refrain, I think, in the 60s, and have been under Forest and Bird's guardianship since then. Anya and I visited the reserves back in April last year for the first time on a bright sunny day, which felt like the sort of coattails of summer. The second time we visited was in May, and already the drizzle had made itself known. And we had two very different experiences of these beautiful, beautiful places. And what we discovered and what we felt when we were there was the intricacy of the forest community, the kind of sense of family and connection within the forest environment, which inspired the circular sort of theme of Anya's artwork, and the idea that beneath our feet, as well as up in the sun-spangled canopies, were ideas of a kind of ancient wisdom that was sort of woven into the forest as well as the soil, and which was the values that were so embodied by the people we met at the Martin group, who are doing the daily mahi to kind of really protect and look after this these precious places. So big thanks to Michael Boss and Smith and Kate Williams in particular for their huge generosity, warmth and friendship. So my poem, my centena, is called Rangitiki Rahui, and in it I've tried to capture these ideas of collaboration. One of the great joys was a collaboration with Anya, with the group, with the natural environment and with Forest and Bird. In tiny emeralds strung along Te Awa, Rangitiki, Turakina, Mangahoe, glinting between vast pastures, hungry deer wander, and fences fall. Here, in glades of green, under silken velvets of spongy moss, mycelium meadows murmur. Delicate hephae sensing into forest leafy felt, lacing earth with life. Puturino drift with flutter and song over Nawairiki Ruakai. As fruits of fungal orchards, jelly, pink and puff, ripen, burst and pop. Above, translucent finery garlands kahikatea, slender stems wavering starward from Matai's damask, up where the mother tree sways. Here, ancient wisdoms told, a story at a time, in tiny emeralds.
So I'm going to play you guys a little bit of this instrument, which is called a puturino, and it's based on the case moth. And the reason I want to play this for you guys is because we were on the road called Puturino Road, which is going down to the Rangitiki Awa. So I'm going to play about four notes just to kind of pull the space into a close.
Hello everybody, my name is Levi Fitzjames and I'm the visual artist for Tarapurihi Bushy Park. Catherine McDonald, who was the writer for this project, unfortunately couldn't be here, but the lovely Jane has gallantly stepped forward to read Cat's Centennial for us soon. Catherine and I got the absolute gift of doing Tarapurihi Bushy Park. Tarapurihi is so named for the abundant bird life. It's a lowland forest sanctuary just north of Whanganui. And it's a place that you can go and visit for free during any daylight hours, or you can also stay overnight at the homestead or at the cabin, which is definitely recommended because you wake up and you hear the beautiful birds in their morning song. It is a place run by an extraordinary group of volunteers, and both Kat and I would like to acknowledge Mandy Brook, who is the sanctuary manager, who just welcomed us with enthusiasm and hospitality, and also a volunteer and artist, Fiona McGowan, who allowed us to go with her while she was cleaning and replenishing the hihi food stations, because it actually allowed us to go off the public paths and to really experience what Tarapurihi is like in its natural abundance. The land and the farmland and forest was gifted to Forest and Bird in 1962 by Frank Moore, who luckily for us was a conservationist as well as a farmer. He had the place fenced off from livestock, but there was but the lowland canopy and the midland canopy was stripped bare by the possums and the rats. So you would think that where you go to now was as it was gifted, but that's not the case. It's actually through the dedication of the volunteers and a 4.8-kilometre predator-proof fence that Tarapurihi is now the abundance of what it is today. There's when you go there, it's just beautiful. There's leaf litter, there's kind of decaying, decomposing huge trees that have fallen that now provide nursery spaces for the little baby trees and plants. And it's just surrounded by huge, beautiful trees, notably the Ratanui, which is an 800-year-old northern rata. Oh, sorry, nervous. It's just a place filled with birdsong. It's filled with movement. It's got insect life. It's just, I don't know, it's a place that transforms you when you go to it. Woven is the painting I created. I really wanted to try and create something that shows how much the life oozes at this place. I wanted it to be full, but I also wanted to create little spaces, because as you're walking through, there are little spaces that open up. It's just, I don't know, it's a very meditative, wonderful place. So both Catherine and I visited many times. We went once together, and what we were both taken with was the light and the shadows and just the vibrancy of the place. We were lucky to go at a time where there was the flowering of the fungi all around, and we both were super taken by just fungi spotting everywhere that we went. We were really inspired by the dedication of the volunteers that worked there. They really do make this place incredibly special. They're there collecting seeds, they're growing saplings, they're planting. I think now they might have just got funding to extend the fence, so it's going to become even more amazing. But what both Catherine and I were really taken with was the shadow and the light, and how the light would just fall, and everywhere you look, there's just this little kind of masterpiece of nature. And so it's with that kind of sense of light and magic that I'd now love for Jane to read Cat's Centennial.
I'm honoured to read Cat's Centennial. Cat is also an artist, and I've been privileged to see some of her work. So she's a multi-gifted person. I've also had the privilege of going to Bushy Park, so this beautifully captures it. In this light, the forest looks fresh, bright. Every surface is alive. The manu are busy. There was a rain the day before, but today there is sun above the canopy, filtering down. The light changes as we move through. The shadows grow solid in places. The forest stills, suddenly thoughtful, waiting. The sun's still there, but hidden now. Beyond, silver light plays on water, a lake formed by a slip. Wherever you look, there is a world, an ecosystem. You get the feeling that nothing is wasted and everything is where it's meant to be, working together in this light.
Kia ora koutou. Ko Samantha Hughes, tōku ingoa. No klue da hau. Kei te whanganui ātara a hau e roho ana. I'm Samantha Hughes, I'm also known as Sam, or also known as Wonky Stitches NZ. I'm the artist for this piece, and I am very honoured today to read out the centenary written by Hayden Maskell, who couldn't come here today. So it's all about Fensham Reserve. Watch your step, through the mud, tangled vines, squelching sodden swampy earth, past the hammered trunks of matai, over crusty bracken and wounded roots, their fibrous nerves exposed, the pain to the air, scraped raw by vibrant tread, and the heavy gait of loping runners. Safer, I think, to wander along the slowly snaking Fensham boardwalk, winding through kahikatea copses, safer to walk along the heavy planks, so expertly sawn, around saplings that poke one finger towards the dark and dappling canopy. A reminder to be quiet, a hush from the leaves, and soft stems reminding us, watch your step. So that was the beautiful centenna created by Hayden Maskell, which captured some of our experience. The artwork and the centenna were created after visiting the beautiful Fensham Reserve, which is in the Wairarapa. For me, the image of the volunteers' hands, the hardworking hands, and the massive mātou that were so well cared for and protected in this lovely environment really resonated with me. I wanted to try and capture and celebrate the effect of the volunteers' work in this gorgeous forest. With their help, it has grown and been protected. I drafted many a sketch in pencil and ink, and then progressed through to using watercolour paints and ink to finish this piece. I hope that the hard-working hands nurturing and protecting the seedling represent the great work that the volunteers have done in this reserve to help the huge matai and other flora to flourish. Along with being contained as much as possible, as much as nature ever is, within a circle that allows a glimpse into the forest and represents the circle of life and how all living things are interconnected. One small act of kindness can help a tree to grow, that can then help to provide shelter and sustenance to the creatures in the area, as well as providing joy to those who visit. So really, it's just a huge thank you to all of the volunteers, Forest and Bird Organisation, and the workers for protecting and conserving this area, as well as so many other areas, for us and for the generations to come. Ngā mihi nui ki a koutou.
My name's Amelia and this is Jane, and I'm the artist and Jane is the writer. We were assigned to the Paotanui Inlet or Paotanui Reserve. If you're not familiar with the reserve, it is about 20-30 kilometres north of Wellington, and just to orientate yourself, if you're looking at this view, that's north. Wellington would be a few hill ranges behind you, and you've got the west coast and Porirua out this way. So the inlet comes in, it's obviously a wetland area, so not so much of a forest reserve as a lot of others have had. Ours is a bit sort of more marshy, and that presented some interesting different things for us to experience. So Jane and I met when you came down to visit the reserve, and I'm a local to this area, so I'm on the Kapiti Coast, so I drive past this all the time, and I had never actually gone inside, despite the fact that it's about 5 minutes drive off the expressway out of Wellington. So we met and we had a really sort of instant natural collaboration and friendship, which has been such a joy to go through this process. We met Robin Chesterfield, who was is sort of in charge of all the volunteers at this area, and we met all his volunteers as well, and it was really interesting. He was a wealth of knowledge, and we learnt a lot walking around the reserve with him, which was good, because actually walking around you don't see a lot of wildlife. As opposed to walking through the forest when, you know, you've got piwaka wakas following you and big fat kereru like following you around. It felt like there was nothing here, and we realised that a lot of the species that are inherent to that area, as well as the fern birds that they've introduced there, they are just tucked away. And that was a concept that we discussed back and forth, which I probably wouldn't have been able to come to this conclusion without you bringing up that concept, Jane, the idea that the animals are watching us secretly, and once we go into the hides, which are stationed around the wetlands, we are in turn watching them, and that we're not inherently part of the land, and actually you do have to hide away to be a part of it, to be able to see. And now the time of day that we went there, it was sort of middle of the day, a bit overcast, but if you go in the morning, and I drive past here every day to go to work, if you're out in the morning and it's low tide, it's a hub of activity, and then it's gone. So I really wanted to encapsulate in my representation of the area the animals that do come out, all the birds, but like I say, you're from a distance, you're removed, you're not really there, and also I have such an attachment to the whole area, so I needed to include the hills and just that context for where we were. It was a really, really lovely experience, and Jane wrote some beautiful words to go along with that. I've just got to check that I said everything.
Okay.
Yeah?
We've got it all.
Said it all?
So,
okay.
So, before I read the centenna, this was an extraordinary creative collaboration for me, because we were all paired together by the extraordinary Caroline Wood of Forest and Bird, who's sitting very quietly in the audience. And she paired us, and most of us, the artists hadn't met the writers. So we were also discovering that as we were discovering our reserves and learning about them, and as you say, the fabulous Robin Chesterfield, who we thought was going to give us an hour and ended up giving us 5 hours. Yes. It was just and very nice cups of tea, and really gave us a sense of what they were dealing with. And so as part of a recognition of the collaboration, I've actually asked if Amelia will open and close the centenna, because I really feel it's not just me with the words and Amelia with the pictures that we did, it was a genuine collaboration. So it's called Pāwatanui, From the Air. Starting now.
From the air, the shore would shimmer with our kin.
White-capped wings, fledgling waves, are a nesting place, an alchemy of sand and salt, mud and brine, undergrounds of tiny crustaceans, constellations of flight lines, intercepted by humankind, blind, it would seem, to the murmurations of Papatūānuku. Now she is restless, her rhythm disrupted, her path uncharted, as she unfurls her foamy petticoats across the bay. The tide seeks refuge beyond filigree borders, across mudflats and meadow grass, seeping into the cottage named Stout.
In the hides they perch, hoping to sight us, while we keen and cry from the air.
Kia ora, whakarofa lahi atu. Guten Abend, good afternoon everybody. I'm Richard Pamatato and this is our artist Lynette. We were e-introduced by Forest and Bird, and it was quite difficult in the beginning because Lynette's schedule is pretty tight, as is mine, so we had a lot of trouble finding a time where we could go to Punakaiki and see the petrels. And then when we did find a date that was useful, we had to get there really early because they were going to close the pass. So Lynette picked me up really early from my hotel, and we had that nervous kind of chat as we went, getting to know each other just a little bit. And then as we went over the pass, we were quite warmed up and started to talk about the petrels. And I had read every academic piece I could find on the petrels. I went through all the journals because I didn't want to look like somebody who didn't know what they were talking about. And then I discovered that Lynn has a PhD in this kind of area. Anyway, we landed an inn on the west coast, and we were given the most extraordinary hospitality by local volunteers. They talked and talked, didn't they, about the history of the reserve, etc., etc. And for me, as someone who often drives up the west coast on the way from our family's house in the Mackenzie, if we drive rather than fly, I was really familiar with Punakaiki, but I had no knowledge of the petrels. And the volunteer who talked about the petrels, unlike those of you who had to slide down things, he made us climb and climb and climb up ladders that he had made in an area that he has donated to protect these extraordinary birds. And he spoke about the threat to them from offshore fishing, from power lines, and actually from the spectre of possibly open cast mining completely up the west coast. So we were kind of given a sense of how important these birds were. And I was really struggling to think about what am I going to write about. And we were up there perched on this little, tiny little seat, and it was quite cold. And he talked about the intergenerational kind of nature of these birds. They go away and they come back, they go away and they come back. And that they are, through that, in the soil, the trees, the water. And actually, we became part of that, didn't we? Oh, you can later, okay. Yeah. So my centena is called Mai Taiko Whakapapa. Mai Taiko Whakapapa. Mai Taiko Whakapapa wings its way away. Down, down, down the ages. A decade passes till home across oceans, navigating, swirling, swishing, mingling. Past becomes present, becomes past, becomes present. See me in flight, silhouetted. Night falls, moon rises, hear me. Brushing against dusk. Crash land, burrow sanctus, to life's chosen with fish, the family dish. Shared incubation keeps warm new life. Oval, repeat, echo. Past becomes present, becomes past to become present. Echo. This slope, its mantle, holds our whakapapa in soil, trunks, streams, leaves, DNA threatened by all you might do to my taiko.
So it was an amazing experience going to visit the Westland Petrels at Taiko. And the Dick Jackson Memorial Reserve, which Forest and Bird owns, is amazingly small. Like, and it's unusual in that it's all focused on this one species. And the petrels, as Richard says, they nest there in burrows in the forest, and you have to climb up quite a long way to get up to these nests up in the forest. And the birds hang out at sea, and then just after it gets dark, they come in. And that was what I was trying to capture. That was, and what Richard was trying to capture too, is this, you can't really see them. They're blackbirds, it's dark, and you can just kind of see them a bit silhouetted, and then so that they had chicks when we were there in the burrows, and they yeah, you could see them going past silhouetted, and then suddenly crash in and kind of waddle around in a sort of a dazed state. So that's what I was trying to capture with the artwork, was the ocean and the land and these birds coming in, and they're quite big. You can see the sort of silhouettes, but it's more about feeling them coming in. Oh, and they're making noises too, weren't they? That once they arrived, they were noisy. Yeah. And the whole thing about they're actually bringing in ocean resources, you know, the fish and everything, onto land. So it's quite a major thing for the ecosystem that we've completely lost in New Zealand now, pretty well, because the whole of the coast of New Zealand would have been covered with nesting seabirds, burrowing seabirds, and now they're so, I mean, the patch where they are is so tiny, just past south of Punakaiki. And yeah, the Forest and Bird volunteers, they talked to us all day, they took turns. And they were very passionate about these birds. But yeah, they're at threat from the predators, they're at threat at sea, and there's just this tiny reserve, and then some dockland, and then, this private land where we actually went up and to see the birds. So it was quite an experience. There we go.
Kia ora koutou, ko Gail and Grim Aho, ko Georgette Thompson. Thompson, sorry. Georgette Thompson, I should know, but we met on first name basis. Calder Green is our reserve. It's on a crooked bend of the lower Pauaho in Christchurch. It's a tiny urban salt marsh reserve, only 1.6 hectares in size, yet it serves a huge purpose. It was named after D.F. Green, who gifted the land to the society in 1980, and Bernie Calder, the Forest and Bird Chair at the time, who worked hard to preserve the Heathcote Avon wetlands from development. It's a striking place. The estuary light brings both serenity and wilderness to the heart of Aotearoa's second biggest city. Yet our human footprint is never more obvious. Once a gathering place and food source for the kaitaho, the first Pākehā settlers set up camp here and one of the first farms. The eastern entrance shares a boundary with an old city council rubbish dump, covered now by the Ferrymead golf course. And at the other entrance, the Littleton motorway roars by. So this place of kotari, spoonbill, shag, and more recently a community-created lizard sanctuary is precious. Precious for people too, urban dwellers who come to walk, bike, replenish, and simply breathe in the beauty of the river, the endangered salt marsh, and all the life it provides. Georgette and I wanted to say in our artworks, and I was inspired completely by her first initial sketch, from now, let us leave only footprints. And so my centena is called Footprints in Carbon. Ihu tai, the prow of the tide, where sea noses river, where tuna met flounder, met kōtiku, a lit totara, where kaitahu mingled at the outpost they called a pāwaho, where the river bends and the oi oi grew, where sails flapped around a devilish elbow, where bullocks strained and councillors drained, where rubbish was dumped and the bitten fled from the final corner of salt marsh on the river, before foresight prevailed and they called it Calder Green. Where we'll meet again, plant makaka for protection, tussock for the skink, where we must stand and staunch the tide as kaitiaki, ihutai, the prow.
So I've lived in Christchurch most of my life, and I'm embarrassed to admit that I had never been to this particular part of the Heathkit, the Kōtā Green Reserve. And prior to our meeting, my lovely writing partner Gail and her husband Mick, who's actually the Forest and Bird Manager of the reserve, they sent me a whole bunch of documents to read over to get a bit of a feel for the place. And what just astonished me was just this, the fact that commercial waste was being poured into the Heathkit River until the early 70s, 1970s, just blew my mind. No wonder there was such a loss of wildlife diversity in that area. So this news haunted me the night before we had our on-site meeting, and I had this image starting to form already in my head. So I scribbled it down so I could show Gail the following day. And Mick and Gail showed me around, and they showed me all the restorative work that they're doing, and they were so energised by these community projects. It really filled me with such hope for the future. I showed Gail my sketch, and to my delight, Gail emailed me later that afternoon and had already written her first draft based off what she'd been inspired by, my little sketch. So I was so stoked that my little thought had sparked the words and let that flow through you. So that was really cool. So my artwork depicts both the positive and negative impacts that humankind has had on the reserve, its wildlife, and the river that flows around it. The man's foot presses into the soft salt marsh, leaving behind a trail of rubbish. The sole of the foot bears skeletons of lost birds, as if scars etched into the skin. In the distance, you can see smokestacks of nearby factories that border the river, those that at some point in the past dumped their commercial waste into the Heathkit. On the bright side, we have our optimistic volunteers striding into the future with seedling and shovel in hand. And the little grass skink, little Canterbury grass skink, peeps out of the shelter of the rock garden that has been built by the community that so desperately wants to protect it. Yes, humankind has had a devastating effect on this reserve, but now volunteers are making such a positive difference. Yeah.
Kia ora koutou, I'm Gabby McKenzie from Otipoti, Dunedin, and this is my artwork, The Gathering. I wanted to do a painting that made you feel like you had stumbled upon a meeting of birds in secret as they're planning their maintenance to restore a place that's really important to them. They're gathered around a rusty old cog, which is a leftover remnant from remu milling that happened for about 100 years on that site. And it's the perfect sort of round table for them to hold their meeting. My birds always are like humans living their best lives, so they're always quite expressive, and they've got little backpacks and thermos flasks for the day. And these birds are all different shapes and sizes, just like us with our conservation work. We all look different, we all have different backgrounds and different values, but we really value our environment, which is so important to us, and so we come together to restore it and look after it for the future. And I'll hand you over.
Thank you, Gabby. I received an email from Gabby about a few days ago. We hadn't met before, and she said, I'll do 45 seconds. I said, okay, good enough. And we immediately bonded on meeting this morning because we both have a boy called Sam. Oh. So it was lovely to meet Gabby. I was lucky enough to go to the Lens Reserve in the Catlins. It's the largest forest and bird reserve. And as we've got the graveyard slot this afternoon, I don't want you to slip into a coma before we just mention the Lens Reserve, because it was gifted by a family. It's the largest and it's exquisite. But my start to the journey from Auckland to the Catlins was not very auspicious. Three things happened. Firstly, I was going to go, I'm Dunedin born, but I live in Auckland, and I was going with two friends, one of whom is a renowned writer, so a bit of name dropping, Fiona Farrell, and her husband Doug were going to come with me to the reserve. And funnily enough, her cousin is Fergus Sutherland, who he and his wife Mary have been guardians of that reserve since they were very young, and they're not very young now. So that was the first thing. The second thing was this horrendous storm. Like, it was in the news down in the Catlins. And I was already a bit nervous, you know, because I had to stay in a hut. You know, and my bottom line is a heated towel rail, a white robe, and some free toiletries. So, you know, the storm was the hut wrecked. I don't know. And the third thing that happened was my son is an ecologist, and I wanted to get a bit of one-upmanship, call me competitive, because I know he's never seen the Tautuku forest gecko, which is exclusively found in the Lens Reserve, and it has blue eyes and an orange tongue. And so I rang Fergus and said, what are my chances of seeing this forest gecko? And he said, quite sagely, oh, about 0.0001%. And I'm delighted to see that Gabby has included the little person there. But anyway, I went with hope. But Fiona and Doug rang me the day before and said, oh, we've got COVID. So I set off on the trip by myself. And there was no internet from, you know, 50 miles out, 50k out or so. And I get lost coming out of a restaurant toilet and end up in the broom cupboard. So it was quite anxious making because I couldn't use my GPS. But I did find my way there, and Fergus and Mary were kind enough to keep the invitation for dinner. So think fresh caught cod and Central Otago apricots. And they are mines of information. They've been there all their lives. They know pretty much everything there is to know, apart from Gavin, who is the pest eradicator. So he showed me the work he's been doing, and he has so far shot 149 deer that season. And that's part of the story as well. But anyway, I arrived there, no internet, so no scrolling, no sourdough bread recipes. And I read a condensed version from the Reader's Digest and nearly started the penguin pristine condition, the periodic table. And none of the card packs were a complete set, so that was out. But I slept like the proverbial rata log. So not having all that stuff around me was really helpful. And the weather was exquisite, like calm, blue skies. And this was all after this crashing storm that was in the news. So this is my centina. Like I'm on the thing. So I caught it through the lens. As they do, lashing storms pass. Rushes slow to a standstill. The windless reserve now heady and sweet. The community emerges, taking the air. Fuzzy koru unfurl, ask questions. Sunlit, intricate patterns play to the gallery. Green mosses well up. Tautuku poke orange tongues. Excited miro chase. Koi pi waka waka. Fan flirt. damage is done. In the shadow, anguished trees lean and drape. Unripe berries drop too soon. Sodden, frail bodies merge with mulch. Banks gape denuded. Dunes simply slip away. But today, spoonbills spoon. Legi kutuku reflect. Cryptic matata mind their business. Karure swoop as they do. I did bring this to show you because Fergus painted this for me to bring home because he knew I wasn't going to get to see one.
Oh.
And I also brought back a great big pack, sorry Sam, of venison. But you know, I feel it's justified because they're pests. But, yeah.
Hello. Well done. I can't see anybody there, eyes closed, which is fantastic. And what a great end, what a great middle, what a great start. Well, not that great a start. But anyway, just thought we'd say hello, and first we're going to say a lot of things, but it's very quickly. You might be wondering what on earth 26 is. Why do we call 26? Have you guessed yet? 26 letters in the alphabet. The alphabet's the DNA of words. We're a whole bunch of writers which started off in London with about 15 people. None of us were there. Now there's about 300 to 400 around the world. And there were three of us in New Zealand. We three. We didn't even know that we were all in the same thing. And it's grown over the last few years. What 26 is a bunch of writers who have very different backgrounds. Some are poets, some are novelists, some are marketing writers, journalists. They're also artists, some of them. Anyone who feels the power of words needs to be out there is welcome to join us. And so far, there's about 20 of us, and we've decided to call ourselves the New Zealand chapter of 26.
So, yeah, first of all, thanks must go to two people, I think. One is John Simmons and one is Caroline Wood for this particular sort of coming together. John Simmons is one of the co-founders of 26 in London, which celebrated its 20th birthday last year. And his mantra, which has also become the mantra of 26, is an E.M. Forster quote, "Only connect." And I think that's something that's come through from all of us who've taken part in this project. We've really enjoyed working with our fellow writers and artists. We've enjoyed working with Forest and Bird, and we've really enjoyed working with the people in the branches. And we've seen how that is embodied in nature as well, that, you know, a lot of people have talked about circles and connection. And this particular sort of connection started with this book and this project, 26 Trees, which was a 26 project out of London, focusing on trees, and Caroline Wood very kindly featured one of the pieces about Rata Nui in Terapuruhi Bushy Park, and that was the start of our particular connection, and it led to a project in 2021 called 26 Habitats and has culminated in this centennial project that we've been celebrating today.
So in fact it was end of 2022 that the effervescent Caroline Wood, buoyed by the success of the previous project, reached out to the New Zealand chapter and suggested this audacious idea of this bringing together of creatives to celebrate 13 reserves. And we, the three of us, started sort of looking at it and talking about it and going, well, how would we do that? We don't have any, we have a few artists that we know. No, said Caroline, I will find those artists for you. I will bring them to you. That's fine, that's less work for us. And so began this extraordinary collaboration, connectedness journey that drew people from different parts of New Zealand, but also took them to different parts of New Zealand. And to be able to say that this project reaches from the top of the North Island down to Sue and Gabby's extraordinary experience in the Catlins, when we thought about the logistics of it, that, you know, this story after story of where people have come from, or the story of Simon putting his art into his van in Christchurch to drive it all the way up here for one day, shows the commitment that has also been picked up on and reflected in some of the presentations today, the commitment of the volunteers, and that how none of this would be possible without them. So the New Zealand chapter of 26 is also a group of volunteers, and we feel very privileged to have been part of this project and the celebration of it today. Thank you.
Just pass back to Kate.
Thank you so much to the three of you for getting the momentum behind this absolutely beautiful celebration of nature. And thank you to all of the artists and writers. It has been a really incredible event. And one of the things that really resonated with me was writers and artists. Conservationists are also very drawn sometimes to darkness. It's a bit in the nature of the subject. But we to look after nature, we need people to really care about it. So it's really important that we motivate and inspire people to want to protect it. And this collaboration, this beautiful collaboration of nature and art, is really, really an exciting opportunity to really inspire people to care about nature in Aotearoa and to do something about really looking after it for us and for future generations. So thank you to everyone who has come here today to celebrate this beautiful event and to share in that. I'm just going to do a short karakia for closing to round off today. Kia tau, kia tātou katoa, kia a iu, te aroha me te marutau, te hei mauri ora. Thanks everyone for coming today, and please come and join us for some refreshments downstairs, and then spend some time upstairs to really go and appreciate in close contact with those beautiful pieces of art that are all being displayed in the room upstairs, and you can also talk with our wonderful artists and writers. Thank you, everyone. Now, make it easy.